I remember the first time I went underwater with scuba gear on, and you feel like an astronaut. You're weightless. Healthy coral reef is one of the most colorful, exquisitely beautiful places on the planet. It is full of color and bustling with life.
You can close your eyes and you can hear the sound of that life. It's fascinating and powerful and really just moving.
If you think about, there are like underwater cities where you have these 3D structures. That's great spaces for little fish to hide in. So they provide important habitat. They provide breeding grounds. So baby fish sometimes will come out and spend a part of their life cycle on the coral reef.
These are really deeply interconnected, dynamic, and energetic ecosystems. Coral are actually animals, and they exist in this just fantastic marriage, this symbiosis with algae that live within the coral, and they are photosynthetic, meaning that they're harnessing the power and the energy from the sun, and they're actually providing food for the coral as an organism. In exchange, if you will, that coral is providing safety and shelter.
They are natural buffers underwater that they actually reduce wave energy to protect coastal communities from flooding and erosion. They provide food and livelihoods and jobs. And so when we lose reefs, we lose those tremendous benefits that they provide to communities around the world.
More than 1 billion people around the world rely on coral reefs for their livelihoods. And so they're vitally important in terms of their economic value. And many of the areas where we find coral are threatened by coastal erosion and storm surges and flooding from storms. And coral reefs play a really central part of protecting those coastal communities. They ultimately reduce that flooding to the tune of about $4 billion around the world each year.
We are coming off of last year, which was the warmest year on record. This year, we're on track to break those records again. Corals are very sensitive to even slight changes in ocean temperature, and so even 1 degree of warming can cause them to have a stress response, to bleach, and then to die if the water stays too hot for too long. Coral reefs are facing this combination of threats. It's not just increasing ocean temperature, changes in ocean chemistry, but it's also that combined with loss of biodiversity due to these other threats that are happening from sedimentation, pollution, overfishing, destructive fishing, and more.
So even if you don't live along the ocean or on the coast or even nearby, you are benefiting from the ocean. The ocean is the driver, the lungs of the planet. So half of the oxygen that we're breathing right now comes from photosynthesis that occurs in the ocean. So we rely on the ocean for every other breath that we take. And so when we think about the future for human impacts, we have to think about not just the communities that are so close and adjacent to coral reefs, but communities around the world that may never see coral reefs, because whether they know it or not, they are benefiting from that diversity and from all that those coral reefs provide for the planet and for people.
This is absolutely a critical time. The scientists predict that by 2050, we could lose up to 90% of the world's reefs. And so what this means for us, what this means for everyone listening in today, is that this is an all hands on deck moment. This means that we need to be bringing in resources, partnerships, capacity, energy, raising awareness, getting everybody recognizing that it matters to save these ecosystems. They are so incredibly important to us.
The window, while it's closing rapidly, it is still open. We still can protect the future for coral reefs on the planet, but the time is running out, and we need to act with more urgency, more focus, and more ambition to achieve that goal. Around the world, we lose about a hectare, so about 2 acres of coral reef every minute. We restore currently, in aggregate, about the same amount of coral every year. So we take that coral from the ocean, we bring it back to a nursery, we cut it up into little bits, and we apply that to what they call a tile, which is about a quarter, half dollar size ceramic plate. And then they grow those up over time in the nursery, cleaning them and caring for them till they get to the size that they can be planted back out onto the reef. That is, at its core, a really robust approach. But what we learned as we started to dig in here is that we were taking really labor-intensive and costly approaches to each step of that. So think about thousands of little quarter-sized tiles. We're moving those one by one, multiple times a week. And we're also using toothbrushes, actual toothbrushes, to clean those little pieces of coral several times a week to prevent the algae buildup that chokes them out and limits their growth and their health. We have to restore at much larger scales. So our team is looking to revolutionize a couple different aspects of how we grow coral at scale and in a cost-effective way. And that means batch handling. It means new software tools to optimize coral nursery operations. It means health and monitoring tools that leverage computer vision and learning algorithms. And it means new approaches to how we protect coral in the nursery from things like algal growth. But in terms of scaling restoration, we think we can actually increase the production opportunity or potential for any single farm to 100 times the leading farm today. We need to ensure that every dollar spent in coral restoration has a maximum impact. And we think that by building, constructing these farms, leveraging these new tools and approaches, we can invest in the farms that are going to produce that impact year over year over year.
We cannot be successful in saving the ocean unless we save coral reefs. Partnering with indigenous groups and local communities is absolutely vital. For a lot of tropical island communities, many of whom have managed these systems, managed these ocean areas for generations and generations. Our teams, our staff, our partners have been working in places for decades. So these relationships, these partnerships based on trust are absolutely vital to our conservation work and its sustainability and success.
So in a place like French Polynesia, we're working with our partners at Coral Gardeners to hold and host multi-stakeholder meetings to get input from scientists and fishermen and local leaders on which parts of the reef they see as most important and most degraded, most in need of restoration.
So with our team at Coral Gardeners, we are focusing on developing tomorrow's new solution to solve the coral reef crisis and to have a tangible impact on the field here. Now we are about to revolutionize ocean conservation and really scale up coral reef restoration around the planet. And with partnership like the Nature Conservancy, with developing those tools, those solutions that will allow us to make this happen, that's how we are going to do it, yeah.
So as you look at the future of coral restoration, it is always going to be place-based. Reefs are adjacent to communities. Reefs exist in place. And so we can't only do this work with a global lens. These solutions have to touch down in places where we're seeing really significant coral loss and where we see an opportunity for coral restoration, all with an eye to ensuring that these are going to be robust solutions that are useful and used in place to achieve our goals.
The Nature Conservancy has been doing coral work for 4 decades, and we have marine projects in over 56 countries. And when you support coral conservation at the Nature Conservancy, you are one, supporting one of the most important ecosystems on the planet, one that is vitally threatened by climate change. But you're also supporting things like helping to reduce the threats in the Caribbean, helping to support local communities in the Pacific to establish locally protected marine areas, helping to support governments to get marine protected areas in place, and building the capacity of their teams and partners to actually manage those effectively. Helping to support restoration projects, where we're actually able to get corals into the water to rebuild the reef framework and then all of those benefits that reefs provide. We bring cutting edge science into all of our work. I'll give an example in the coral reef space. We have a partnership with Stanford and Woods Hole called Super Reefs to identify and protect climate resilient reefs. We're using 3D hydrodynamic modeling. We're using genetics, and we're bringing all of that to support our conservation work. But in another example, TNC, actually our Pacific team, Yim Golbu, who's one of our brilliant marine scientists in Micronesia, just was awarded a grant as part of a coral reef R&D accelerator.
What we're trying to do with this new grant is to how do we best ensure that coral reefs will continue to survive into the future, and how do we restore areas that have been damaged, but not just restore for today, but restoration, thinking about the future. And so we will be using heat-tolerant corals to restore degraded reefs with the hope that as the water temperature continues to heat up, that these areas will have a better chance of surviving.
This is literally bringing some of the most cutting-edge practices in coral restoration and piloting them across the Pacific. So it's having that, you know, building on those decades of best management practices, but bringing in some of the latest and greatest innovations in science. I I think people feel like it's lost. They read these headlines that corals are declining and there's nothing we can do. That's not true. There are so many things we can do to ensure a future for coral reefs. I mean, we are absolutely at a make or break point with reef systems, and we have got to be leveraging all of the partnerships, the capacity, and the finances together so that we are leaning in to make sure that these systems have a future.
One of the most important roles that folks can play in addressing this issue right now is with risk-tolerant philanthropy. And what I mean by that is we are in solution development and R&D stage. So we are iterating on these tools. We are constructing farms. We are in a rapid development, prototyping, and learning phase. And frankly, that is not the best fit for national funds or federal funds from the US government or others. What we need are philanthropists that share our vision for protecting a future for coral on the planet and are willing to take a risk and provide nimble and flexible philanthropic capital to our team and to our partners to allow us to build this new solution. And then we're going to be able to scale through public investments. We can invest in building the solutions today that are going to move the needle and shape the future for coral restoration over the rest of our lifetimes. So dollars spent today are going to have an outsized impact in terms of what we're able to ultimately achieve in terms of protecting coral's future. We are ultimately trying to do something that hasn't been done before, certainly at the scales that we're talking about. I think people get fired up and excited about that. And I think they're excited to be part of a moment and an effort that is addressing what we are all so heartbroken to see, the loss of coral reefs. So people are really excited about the project and about the innovation and about the outcome that we can achieve together.
What gives me hope is our incredible ocean staff around the world and our partners. I mean, these are people who wake up every single day trying to save the ocean and trying to save our coral reefs. Seeing their commitment, their passion, their expertise, how they're working together and sharing knowledge with each other, the fact that we are starting to see change, we're seeing places where we've restored corals that have been damaged, that all gives me hope for the future.
Every single day when I wake up to work on this project, I am confident that we are marching in the direction of success. I think we can do this. I am confident that the technologies that we're working on are ultimately going to radically increase the production of coral for restoration and drive down the cost. I know that will happen. We have hope that we can transform the practice of coral restoration and meaningfully improve the prospects for coral on Earth. We can do big things. We can do hard things if we work together, if we're ambitious and collaborative. And I think in this moment, we need like-minded folks to invest in the solutions that we're building.